I thought I would introduce this video. It's kind of a mashup, and it was inspired by a Drew Bloom live stream, which he did about Kim Clement and his daughter, who is now merchandising his false prophecies.
Hello, friends. I'm Donna Clement Petrushka, and I am honored to invite you to something truly extraordinary.
With my leopard skin top, freshly hunted in South Africa. She's truly honored, right? Of course she's honored. This is a huge money-making opportunity for her.
The Kim Clement Prophecy Vault.
However, he also included some information that is quite shocking. And I have actually talked about this before in other videos, particularly about Paul Kane and the possibility that he was involved in occult training through the paranormal division of a certain agency. This fits in with what I normally talk about on this channel, which is the occult and New Age infiltration of the church. I would also like to point out that the New Age is not just a spiritual movement, it's also a political movement, and it's kind of a synonym of New Age, New Order. Those kind of go together. As Christians, we know the Bible tells us all about this, but what we have here is like the really big picture of kind of like an orchestrated, systematized effort to create an ecumenical one world religion, which has been in progress being built simultaneously over decades and a century and probably maybe throughout all human history. And these things go together. You cannot have a world government without a world religion to bring people into unity. In order to bring about a world government, a world religion is necessary to achieve that. So I'm adding a few clips from prior videos and some newer information. So what if these false prophets and different spiritual leaders are using occult techniques in order to make contact with the spiritual realm and in order to get you or their followers to be connected to this spiritual realm and spiritual entities that don't serve God? And what if they're being used to facilitate a new world religion, a new world religion of ecumenicalism and dominionism, leading straight to the Book of Revelation, where they will have been prepared and readied for following a false Christ? I found this video about remote viewing and covert psychic warfare. I'm just going to read a description so you understand a little bit. This is called Remote Viewing Pioneer and Physicist Russell Targ. This is from 2016. Dark Journalist, interview with remote viewing pioneer and physicist Russell Targ on the new Third Eye Spies documentary coming out this fall. ESP, mind control, psychic targeting, intuitive vision, deep military programs, stargates, CIA black budget experiments. The man who started it all. Enjoy this powerful Dark Journalist episode as he goes deep into the covert remote viewing program bankrolled by the agency with physicist Russell Targ, who founded the effort at Stanford Research Institute, SRI, with fellow physicist Hal Puthoff. In this Third Eye Spies, in this special part one episode, they delve deeply into the clandestine world of psychic spies and discuss the new documentary Third Eye Spies on Targ's classified work with extraordinary gifted remote viewers like artist Ingo Swan, military officer Joe McMoneagle, and Burbank Police Commissioner Pat Price, who died shortly after remote viewing a UFO base and being directly recruited out of the program into clandestine operations. Now the man who ran it all, Russell Targ, can tell the whole story. Here's the good part, or the bad part. Psychic Warriors, Targ recounts amazing details of developing the remote viewing program for the agency and the national security incidents that he and his team were involved with at the very highest levels of government. He also recalls his early days of being interested in metaphysics and learning about powerful intuitives like Helena Blavatsky and Edgar Cayce at his father's bookstore in Chicago.
Thinking aloud. Conversations on the leading edge of knowledge and discovery with psychologist Jeffrey Mishlov.
So I went to graduate school at Columbia,
mm-hmm.
and
in physics.
In physics.
Yep.
And in the course of that, I was taken to a lecture at the Theosophical Society
mm-hmm.
by one of my students, co-students, and we heard about Bridie Murphy, who was a supposedly reincarnated Irish woman who remembered a previous life. And I met a number of the Theosophical bigwigs at the time, including Dora Kunz,
mm-hmm.
who ran the Theosophical Society, and she was a psychic healer.
Mm-hmm.
I became friends with her and discovered that she could locate magnets in her office. If I would hide a magnet, she could see where it was, because she told me that she had that psychic ability.
In other words, she was able to visualize the magnetic field.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I became very interested in the Theosophical Society. They had an early journal of the Theosophical magazine in which Annie Besant wrote an article called Occult Chemistry.
Annie Besant being one of the founders, along with Madame Blavatsky, of... with Madame Blavatsky of the Theosophical Society.
So in 1895, Annie Besant in India
mm-hmm.
was looking... In Theosophy, they believe you can experience the universe by your direct perception.
Mm-hmm.
In Theosophy, they believe you can experience the universe by your direct perception.
Mm-hmm.
Is a kind of pantheistic view.
Yeah.
The universe is available, and it's available to your experience and your direct perception. And Madame Blavatsky had the idea that her two prodigious psychics, Charles Leadbeater and Annie Besant, could sit in front of a block of paraffin at the laboratory in Edgar, India, and describe the atoms. And they started with hydrogen, because that's the lightest one.
Mm-hmm.
And they were able to describe hydrogen, which they drew in a peculiar ideographic
yeah.
form.
Mm-hmm.
And then said there's actually two other kinds of hydrogen, which they called occultium, which has one extra thing in it, atomic mm-hmm. unit, and edgerium, named after the city that they were in.
Mm-hmm.
So they had really discovered the two isotopes of hydrogen in the late 1800s, before the idea of isotopes even existed,
mm-hmm.
let alone the discovery of those two isotopes.
And as a graduate student in physics at the time, you were able to recognize the significance.
I found that very exciting. I was yeah. so, like, I didn't understand all of Theosophy and the secret doctrine, but I understood these people are really onto something, that psychic abilities can go way beyond playing cards.
Mm-hmm. And I think it's fair to say, although the Theosophical Society is a rather small and obscure movement today, that historically speaking, they've had an enormous impact. Enormous impact.
That's right. And they still have a sizable following in England.
Mm-hmm. I think there may be 5,000 members in the United States today.
They published my last book, for example.
Uh-huh.
They published my Reality of ESP.
Quest Books, their publisher.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I thought that was nice.
Mm-hmm.
Review of Ecumenical Quest for a World Federation by Martin Erdman, The Rise of Modern Dominionism. Before the religious right, there were decades of activity laying the groundwork for a merger of church and state. For a merger of church and state. Power elite leaders such as John Foster Dulles and his brother Alan began to drum up religious fervor as a tool to build their utopian vision of a global international order. Their influential efforts would eventually gain more traction during the Eisenhower administration, where both of these brothers ascended to prominent positions of power. By 1980, their vision would culminate in the rise of the Christian right.
Is this vast right-wing conspiracy?
So if you don't know, Alan Dulles and John Dulles were involved in the beginning of the CIA. I know Alan Dulles was part of Project Paperclip that brought a bunch of Nazi war criminals over here to be part of our country and our military and our NASA and our medical, psychological, industrial complex, everything. Wow. This fascinating early history is now more readily available to readers. Dr. Martin Erdman has just re-released his landmark study on the earliest efforts to build the kingdom of God on earth, otherwise known as Dominionism. His book is now offered online under a new title, Ecumenical Quest for a World Federation. This book is available here and here. I could not find it under that former title, but I did find it under this title, World Federation, the Ecumenical Agenda. You can find it now on Amazon. Dr. Erdman's work was originally titled Building the Kingdom of God on Earth, the Church's Contribution to Marshall Public Support for World Order and Peace. Okay, so this is about how the church has been infiltrated and influenced to help build the New World Order, basically.
The great story here, for anybody willing to find it and write about it and explain it, is this vast right-wing conspiracy that
worldwide network of organizations and individuals that were dedicated to three overarching goals: New World Order, New World Religion, and a New Age Messiah. And
is this vast right-wing conspiracy that
there was the shared expectancy on the three levels.
Is this vast right-wing conspiracy that
said they're both groups, banners for all cult groups to see, merge behind, and united in an expectation of overthrowing the existing order.
Is this vast right-wing conspiracy that
and united in an expectation of overthrowing the existing order.
Is this vast right-wing conspiracy that
and united in an expectation of overthrowing the existing order.
Regarding the use of psychological warfare on civilians by the government with the use of religion, in 1951, Truman set up the, get this name, the Psychological Strategy Board, PSB, comprising the CIA, Departments of State and Defense, and others, and studied, quote, the potential role of religion in psychological warfare. Their first report stated that, quote, the potentialities of religion as an instrument for combating communism are universally tremendous. Religion is an established force which calls forth men's strongest emotions. Our overall objective in seeking the use of religion as a Cold War instrumentality should be the furtherance of world spiritual health.
Is this vast right-wing conspiracy, the right-wing conspiracy?
That I get passionate about this because I love, as do all of you, we love Jesus Christ in truth and sincerity. We want to serve our Lord and Savior who died for our sins, who shed his blood, who suffered for us to pay our price. And these people are the people that drag underfoot that precious gospel, and they just shipwreck everyone's faith because they don't fear God. So I'm only trying to defend the gospel of Jesus Christ against New Apostolic Reformation snakes who have stolen the glory of Jesus Christ. It only belongs to Jesus, and they placed it on themselves and upon their fake God. They've made Trump a God.
not a president, a prophet, who has stood the test of time and is exposing all of this without him even knowing it. His anointing is exposing every corruption. His anointing is exposing corruption, and America shall rid itself, says the Lord, of leeches that take and they give nothing back.
America shall relieve itself of leeches? Will that ever happen? No, the answer is no. There will always be corruption. This is like when Kent Christmas said that, oh God, thus saith the Lord, God's going to end racism. It's a great thought. I wish that was true. But that just basically means that there'll be no more evil in the world. In fact, I think he might have actually said, or that was Bo Polny on an Alabama Woodsman video. Apparently evil was supposed to be eradicated from the whole earth last year or 2022. So what you notice in Kim Clement, you've got the rock and roll band. There's always music playing. And what he does, his shtick, is he works the crowd into emotional frenzy until they're, I mean, this is the same like when you used to go to a rock concert and wait for your favorite band to play that their best hit. Or it's like the climax in a really good movie, right? Where it's building up tension and this is what he did. And they just want to believe so bad that this guy's an actual prophet. It's a joke.
And prove myself, because the angel that has come to reveal the mystery, as in Revelation 10, it has been spoken, says the Lord, that there is an angel that says, we have blown the trumpet, the final trumpet. Now, the mystery that was spoken by the prophets of old shall be opened up for this generation to hear the secrets of God and take the kingdom by force, says the Lord. Take the kingdom by force, says the Lord. Do you want to win the battle, says the Lord? Do you want to? Then God said, I will take away the lethargy of the old. I will take away the Eli priest, and there will be deaths. There will be deaths over the summer. But God said, do not fear, because I'm taking out the old order. Because I'm taking out the old order. I'm taking those that are in the temple and corrupting them with adulterous actions, and what they are doing in the temple has brought an odor to me, says the Lord. I will remove them, but Samuel shall arise, David shall arise, Daniel shall arise, Esther shall arise, and God says these will infiltrate the entire system, and God says, but the old order is precious to me. I will take TBN, I will take TBN, I will take TBN.
Then tonight, this hue and cry and controversy that has been spawned by the devil to try and bring dissension within the body of Christ, that we're gods. I am a little God.
Yes. Yes.
I have his name. I'm one with him. I'm in covenant relationship. Yeah. I am a little God. Critics,
you are
be gone.
Anything that he is.
Yes.
And when I raise up the family, God said that there will be health and wealth in this nation. Would you give God a shout of praise as he speaks these words? I will take exactly what I said and make it happen, says the Lord. An economic revival is on its way as I take these kingdoms into my hands.
Is the sound of a wealth transfer coming into this atmosphere? Is the sound of a millionaire?
Is on its way as I take these kingdoms into my hand.
I shall take the sword, and Elisha shall walk to the same Jordan that was crossed over before. And God says he will say, where is the God of Elijah? Where is the God of Billy Graham? Where is the God of Oral Roberts? Where is the God of the greats of yesterday? Of the greats of yesterday. For God says these men have already been accompanied by angels to bring them into my presence. At this papal discussion, God said there will also be confusion. But God said the Catholic Church shall be known as mine. For I am about to take the Parakletos. I'm about to take the Parakletos. I'm about to take the Parakletos and give it to them, says the Lord. I speak of my Holy Spirit. I speak of the Holy Spirit shall be given to the Roman Catholic Church. God said, I will put in the papal, into the Pope, a spirit of jealousy. For God said he will be jealous, and he will say God must be God, and they will say you cannot change it, it's gonna stay the way it is. But you watch, says the Lord, over a 3-year period, how I will change things. And they will say there is only one God, there is only one saint, there is only one God, and he is the Lord Jesus Christ. For this shall be a miraculous invasion of millions of people. But God said, now I will shake the United Nations, and God says, I will abolish it. I will abolish it. I shall abolish the United Nations church, because my church is supposed to bring unity. My church is supposed to bring finances, and the economy is going to change, because I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it, says the Lord. Come on, hallelujah.
So now here's where we get into the occult. So I asked God, you know what, I'll just say it like this. I always pray, God, if there's anything you would want me to expose, help me to find it. I'm going to do my research. Bless my efforts to find it. And I found it. I found something here. I think maybe many of you don't know. Here is the daughter, Donna, in a random interview.
He
I'm not sure.
They were writing things down that I cannot repeat. I will not be allowed next week.
Right.
December 30th of 2014, he said that within a month, a tumor was growing in his brain. He has a stroke, and he has 4 strokes. And then at the end of that, we find out, and that was over a 4 or 5 month period, we find out he has a brain tumor. So we asked them, we asked the doctors, how long has he had this brain tumor? And they said, well, measuring the rate of growth, we would say it began growing in his brain in January of 2015. He worked with the FBI after 9/11. Next thing, the FBI showed up at my parents' house. At the time they were living in Texas, the FBI shows up at the house. You know, this man must have known something. You know, obviously at the end of it, they figured out, no, he didn't. He didn't even remember prophesying it. That they asked him to join this project, Stargate or whatever it was called. I can't remember now. Obviously at the end of it, they figured out, no, he didn't. He didn't even remember prophesying it. That they asked him to join this project, Stargate or whatever it was called.
Project Stargate. Now here is Donna herself telling you. He joined, as far as I know, he did join Project Stargate. Remember that, write it down. Feel free to Google it later after the live stream here. But here's the daughter. She's the one telling the story. Now, for those of you that don't know,
I can't remember now.
Well, woman in this video is Kim Clement's daughter. She admits Kim doesn't remember prophecy after he gives them, right? The FBI recruits Kim for Project Stargate after 9/11. He works with Project Stargate until his death. They wouldn't let him out. Now, can we absolutely confirm that? No. No. But this is just the beginning, scratching the surface. I have a feeling of what I think is going to come to the surface here. If you can read this at the bottom, it says Project Stargate was created for psychics.
This video is going to upset some people, but Kim Clement was not a prophet from God. In reality, he was a psychic medium, or in other words, a false prophet. Now, before you allow your emotions to take over, please just listen. In his book, Call Me Crazy, But I'm Hearing From God, he writes, quote, my mother took me to an apartment in our little town where a woman resided who claimed psychic powers. During our visit, the psychic took my hand and did a reading. She told me that I would travel overseas as a musician and that I would become famous. My inhibitions were removed by her flattery. I listened with wonderment as she portrayed exactly what I was dreaming of becoming. I was a little fearful, yet intrigued by the mystical atmosphere. Remember this idea of mysticism. We left with nothing much to say, although I imagine the advice of the clairvoyant was taken to heart by my mother, who leaned toward this kind of spiritualism. For me, this experience opened my eyes to a supernatural world I had not sensed in the few church trips I had made in my short life. This is critical to understand how this was his foundation, a psychic telling him that he would travel overseas and become famous. And not just famous, but being famous as a musician, which he ties his prophecies with him playing worship music. And also him being intrigued by the mystical atmosphere is crucial to understand because Kim Clement became part of the NAR. Now you may be asking, what is the NAR? It is the New Apostolic Reformation. Now the NAR is an unbiblical religious movement that emphasizes experience over scripture, mysticism over doctrine, and modern day apostles over the plain text of the Bible. Of particular distinction in the New Apostolic Reformation are the role and power of spiritual leaders and miracle workers, the reputation of new revelations from God, and an overemphasis on spiritual warfare and a pursuit of cultural and political control in society. The seeking of signs and wonders in the NAR is always accompanied by blatantly false doctrine. Let this sink in for a second, because Kim would claim to be a prophet from God, working miracles and receiving new revelations from God. Even though we know scripturally, if a prophet misses one prophecy, he is a false prophet. And Kim missed prophecies, but yet he claimed that is okay. Now, I really want to focus on this idea right here and pursuit of cultural and political control in society. It sure makes me think about his Trump prophecies. Now, I'm going to show you a clip of his daughter talking about a few things, and then we'll talk about it.
Worked with the FBI after 9/11. FBI showed up at my parents' house. At the time, they were living in Texas. The FBI shows up at the house. Now, this man must have known something. You know, obviously, at the end of it, they figured out, no, he didn't even remember prophesying. But they asked him to join this project, Stargate, or whatever it was called.
Here is the Gateway Project. The 37-page document and 11 tapes were declassified in 2003. A CIA-hired scientist and mystic, Itzhak Bentov, was tasked to assess the Gateway Experience process as a part of the CIA's wider investigation into whether concepts of mind control and hypnosis could be used in espionage efforts of the Cold War. So the CIA was like, oh wow, we found the secret to the universe, but how do we weaponize this against our enemies?
In 2017, the CIA published documents regarding a project called Project Stargate. This was a project started in 1978 and suspended in 1995, investigating the efficacy of supernaturals in surveillance, interception, and intelligence gathering. Although it was shut down in 1995, the CIA and MI6 continue to utilize psychics to date under different code names. In this class, I will be attempting to reshape the Stargate project as the Seers project. To train you to accurately partner with the Holy Spirit.
Now with the Holy Spirit.
I can always tell when somebody's lying. I just need to know two things. What the person is saying, and what the truth is. And if those things are different, the person's lying.
With the Holy Spirit, should God call upon you to serve your nation with the prophetic ministry? This project is intended to sharpen your spiritual senses and create CIA-level activations that help improve your perception, interception, and communication of spiritual languages. Are you ready for the Seers Project?
Ah!
Hey guys, exciting news. We're fully booked again for the premiere of the CIA course, which so many of you have been excited about getting tickets for. Now, tickets are free and they're available. So we've decided that we are going to add 1,000 more tickets to the premiere. So make sure you register quickly. It was amazing that they were fully booked within the first hour. Many of you wrote to us saying, are there any more tickets? So we've added 1,000 more. That means we're only taking 2,000 of you on board this premiere. So make sure you register. Can't wait to see you there. Get ready.
Okay, so here I am just looking for a photo of Paul Kane, and I came across this. It's a fan page. It's a memory album. Special memories of Paul Kane back in the day. Back in the day, he was a big guy. He used to stand in for William Branham. But this is what's really interesting. Governmental diplomacy. What? Well, here he is with this guy. Do you know this guy? I don't know this guy. He looks important, though. Yeah, Bill Clinton again. Yeah. And, oh, here he is with Saddam Hussein. Oh, here he is with Saddam Hussein again. And here he is with, I guess that's Saddam Hussein's, somebody. I remember his face. I don't remember his name. Sorry. And look, check it out. Here he is with Bibi Netanyahu. What is up with this guy? Is he a secret agent man?
Secret agent man, secret.
But Paul told us just about one of the things I remember is he told us about the heart of President Bill Clinton and his genuine heart for the Lord.
So I was looking up some things about Paul Kane and Saddam Hussein, stuff like that, and I came across this book. Paul Kane, a prophet in the Hall of Kings, between Iraq and a hard place. And here's the description, which was very surprising. Is any of this really true? I don't know. He is Dr. Paul Kane, evangelist and public speaker for over 60 years, former senior diplomatic advisor for the Washington Federal News Service. Consultant to CIA, DIA Intelligence Agency, Paranormal Division. Consultant to the FBI, National Center for Intelligence and Counterterrorism. And Presidential Consultant and Special Envoy for 3 presidents. This book, Paul Kane, A Prophet in the Hall of Kings, is not a full-scale biography, though it does sketch a personality portrait with some key moments in his life. Instead, this book mostly focuses on foreign policy with an emphasis on the Iraq of Saddam Hussein's era and the Middle East. Readers will be taken inside the meetings that he had with foreign diplomats, several presidents, their staff, key advisors, and close friends. While still in his mother's womb, an angel appeared to his mother with a message from the Lord. The fruit of your womb is a male child. Name him Troas Paul. He will preach the gospel as the Apostle Paul of old, and he will prophesy to kings and presidents. All of this came to pass exactly as it was told, and is continuing to unfold even now. In 1985, while the Central Intelligence Agency CIA Project Stargate was in full swing, Dr. Kane was contracted as a remote viewer by George H.W. Bush's administration for 2 terms. President Clinton tasked him to travel to Iraq on several top secret missions of national urgency.
Secret agent man.
Unknown to Dr. Kane, President Clinton, or Saddam Hussein, decisions they made would set in motion a chain of events that would topple Middle Eastern leaders, send a wave of Islamic fundamentalist terrorism coursing towards America, and set in motion the end of days. You must find out what Saddam Hussein meant when he told Dr. Kane, President Clinton is the hope of Iraq and the hope of the world. Wow. I cannot believe what I just read. I was really not expecting to find that? Is this guy really a secret agent man? Is this prophet a government agent and a remote viewer? We're going to look into what remote viewing is. And it's very interesting. Is it possible some of these prophets have been trained in this or what? I don't know. Some of this information, it might be speculative. I haven't verified if he was legitimately a agent of the government. But we do have pictures of him with Saddam Hussein and Bibi Netanyahu and all these other things. So why even talk about Paul Kane now? He is gone. Well, he's a direct link to the Latter Rain and William Branham, which is what the New Apostolic Reformation is based on, the Latter Rain teachings from the 1940s. He was there. Not only that, but allegedly he was a predator. And he threatened people. Allegedly. And he's allegedly a secret agent man. He also heavily promoted Todd Bentley. As you know, on my channel, I am exposing false prophets and also seeing how these false prophets and false teachers and how their teachings and their practices connect to the occult. So this might actually be very relevant in this exploration or investigation or whatever you want to call it. Bam!
And just as my boot made contact with her nose, she fell under the power of God.
But the Lord sent them here for such a time as...
The following clip is me reading from the actual Stargate document, and I have added subtitles because it's kind of hard to read along. It's a lot, it's very busy. And so I apologize, but that's how it is. It's very busy. So I added subtitles at the bottom so that you can read along. Stargate Collection, Analysis and Assessment of Gateway Process. 9 June 1983. Okay, this is a document that I had found a few years ago and I thought it was very interesting or kind of mind-blowing. But I never thought I would be using this on my channel that I made because it didn't seem to be connected, you know. But maybe it is. I don't know. The following document was obtained by the Black Vault through the Freedom of Information Act, FOIA, and was part of the Stargate Collection release. It is a 1983 assessment of what Lieutenant Colonel whatever Wayne McDonnell thought about what was called the Gateway Process. This dealt with hypnosis, holograms, and out-of-body experiences, just to name a few things. According to his introduction memo, as submitted to the U.S. Army, quote, "You tasked me to provide an assessment of the Gateway experience in terms of its mechanics and ultimate practicality. As I set out to fulfill that task, it soon became clear that in order to assess the validity and practicality of the process, I needed to do enough supporting research and analysis to fully understand how and why the process works. Frankly, sir, that proved to be an extremely involved and difficult business. Initially, based on conversations with the physician who took the Gateway training with me, I had recourse to the biomedical models developed by Itzhak Bentov to obtain information concerning the physical aspects of the process. Then I found it necessary to delve into various sources for information concerning quantum mechanics in order to be able to describe the nature and functioning of human consciousness. I had to be able to construct a scientifically valid and reasonably lucid model of how consciousness functions under the influence of the brain hemisphere synchronization technique employed by Gateway. Once this was done, the next step involved recourse to theoretical physics in order to explain the character of the time-space dimension and the means by which expanded human consciousness transcends it in achieving Gateway's objectives. Finally," this is very interesting, "finally, I again found it necessary to use physics to bring the whole phenomenon of out-of-body states into the language of physical science to remove the stigma of its occult connotations, and put it in a frame of reference suited to objective assessment. Okay, so this is a 30-page document, and I am just going to skip. Paradoxically, having gone to such great lengths to avoid trying to render judgments based on an occult or dogmatic frame of reference, in the end, I found it necessary to return, at least briefly, to the question of the impact of the Gateway Experience on common belief systems. The danger exists that some people will reject the whole concept of the Gateway Experience on the mistaken belief that it contradicts and is therefore alien to all that they hold to be right and true. So, this is the introduction. The Gateway Experience, Brain Hemisphere Synchronization in Perspective. It talks about hypnosis, transcendental meditation, talks about in the Bentov biomedical model as described in a book by Lee Sanella, MD, entitled Kundalini Psychosis or Transcendence. The number 5, Gateway and Hemisync. Now that we have briefly profiled the basic mechanics of the principal techniques for altering or expanding consciousness, which share some of the objectives and or methods employed by the Gateway Experience, we may proceed to focus on what that technique actually involves. Fundamentally, the Gateway Experience is a training system designed to bring enhanced strength, focus, and coherence to the amplitude and frequency of brainwave output between the left and right hemispheres, so as to alter consciousness, moving it outside the physical sphere, so as to ultimately escape even the restrictions of time and space. The participant then gains access to the various levels of intuitive knowledge which the universe offers. Wow. This is so weird. This is what our military is investigating. Holograms. Time-space dimension. Up to this point, our discussion of the gateway process has been relatively simple and easy to follow. Now the fun begins. Gateway involves more than just perception of those aspects of the universal hologram, which can be accessed in the dimension of time-space as we know it. To explain how and why human consciousness can be brought to transcend the limitations of time-space is the next task which must be addressed. To do this, we must first appreciate that time and space are in order to understand how the dimension that they constitute can be transcended. Okay, I'm going to keep going, but they're talking about space, time travel?
My guest says Jesus is the original time traveler. Time travel is real, and he has proof. Next.
Okay, dimensions in between. Now that we have postulated the legitimacy of the assertion that the energy forms which compose consciousness can move beyond the time-space dimension, we need to turn our attention to the energy forms which inhabit those dimensions between time-space and the absolute. In so doing, we may better perceive the form that reality assumes when we encounter it in those intermediate dimensions. Special status, out-of-body experience. Although human consciousness can, with enough practice, move beyond the dimension of time-space and interface with other energy systems in other dimensions, the entire process is appreciably enhanced if that consciousness can be detached in large measure from the physical body before such interface is attempted.
I said, that's the voice, the utterance, the words. Boom, you have an authority of the word of knowledge and the prophetic. When it merges together with your style, bam, it's the utterance. And I said, me? I'm out there. I'm E equals MC squared, seven mountain strategy. I'm out there. And I accept that. But what was interesting to me
was how when Kim came back into his body, he had gone through from this realm here, the earth realm, which is first heaven. This is the atmosphere surrounding the earth. And so you can see 1, 2, 3. By the way, what I'm giving you now are secrets. These are my little secrets, secret stories of Kim, secret stories I'm sharing. And we're going to go to the third heaven anointing, because I believe what Kim did was he went up and he came down, and it was a predictive of a third heaven anointing. I want you to go to LanceWallnow.com/secrets. Secrets. Got some secrets to tell this week. LanceWallnow.com/secrets.
Yikes. Quality of consciousness. We noted earlier that the out-of-body state involves projection of a major portion of the energy pattern that represents human consciousness so that it may move either freely throughout the terrestrial sphere for purposes of information acquisition or into other dimensions outside of time-space, perhaps to interact with other forms of consciousness within the universe. Other forms of consciousness within the universe. Consciousness in perspective. Having ascertained that human consciousness is able to separate from physical reality and interact with other intelligences in other dimensions within the universe.
And interact with other intelligences in other dimensions within the universe.
And that it is both eternal and destined for the ultimate return to the absolute. Having ascertained that human consciousness is able to separate from physical reality and interact with other intelligences, maybe that's why they're called intelligence agencies. Okay, gateway method. Having put the gateway experience in context by postulating a structural outline of how and why it seems to work and having shown what it is designed to achieve, the time has come to examine the specific techniques which compromise the gateway training process. And then it talks about high energy states and transcendental meditation. And the gateway process begins by teaching the individual participant to isolate extraneous concerns in a visualization device called an energy conversion box. Next, the participant is introduced to a method of encouraging his mind and body to strive to achieve a state of resonance through utterance of a single tone. You know, like they do in yoga and stuff. Following this, the participant is exposed to the gateway affirmation and is encouraged to repeat it to himself as he hears it repeated on the tape. This affirmation is a statement to the effect that the individual realizes that he is more than merely a physical body and that he deeply desires to expand his consciousness. So basically what I think is everything on here is things that you should not do. Okay, we'll keep going. We've got the hemi-sync introduced. That's where you sync up your left and right brain. The energy bar tool. That is interesting. Energy bar tool. Magic wands and enchanted scepters have been part of the folklore and occult practices of many cultures. The scepters, staffs, and maces carried by monarchs and high priests alike occur with such frequency in the history of bygone eras as to suggest that at the very least, these items are aspects of some type of archetypical symbol, which the human mind seems to appreciate, perhaps quite subliminally. In any case, the energy bar tool technique involves envisaging a small, intensely pulsating dot of light, which the participant charges in his imagination with enormous energy until it is virtually pulsating. The participant then extrudes the dot into the shape of a sparkling, vibrating cylinder of energy, which he then uses to channel force from the universe to selected parts of his body for purposes of healing and revitalization. Are you kidding me? This is like Star Wars, remote viewing. In addition, the energy bar tool is used as a portal for initiating a follow-on technique called remote viewing. In this context, the participant turns his bar of energy into a whirling vortex through which he sends his imagination in search of a new and illuminating insights. The apparent purpose of the symbolism involved in the vortex seems to be to cue the subconscious and convey to it the instructions as to what the participant wishes to do, but in terms of nonverbal symbols which the right hemisphere of the mind is capable of understanding. That sounds like Merkaba. I don't know, maybe? Focus 15, traveling into the past. They're traveling into the past. They're traveling into the future.
The bed, and I look back, and my body is not in the bed. So I realize I'm going. And they take me through the roof, and I was through the roof so fast, I just didn't even hardly know you went through it, other than, whoa, where's the roof? And while I am there, I land 3,000 years earlier.
With these techniques. And then there's out-of-body movement. Yes, this remarkable phenomenon has been saved for discussion in detail until last because of the interest in which it occasions and special circumstances involved in its attainment. Information collection potential. The information acquisition potential associated with out-of-body state seems to attract the most attention from the standpoint of developing practical applications for the gateway technique. Belief system considerations. In 1967, Alexandra David Neal and Lama Yongden wrote a book entitled Secret Oral Teachings in Tibetan Buddhist Sects, from which the following quote is taken. The tangible world is movement, say the masters. Not a collection of moving objects, but movement itself. There are no objects in movement. It is the movement which constitutes the objects which appear to us. They are nothing but movement. I've cited this quotation because it shows that the concept of the universe, which at least some physicists are now coming to accept, is identical in its essential aspects with the one known to the learned elite in selected civilizations and cultures of high attainment in the ancient world. The concept of the cosmic egg, for example, is well known to scholars familiar with the ancient writings of the Eastern religions, nor are the theories presented in this paper at variance with the essential tenets of the Judeo-Christian stream of thought.
False.
The concept of visible reality, i.e. the created world, as being an emanation of an omnipotent and omniscient divinity who is completely unknowable in his primary state of being. The absolute at rest in infinity is a concept, get this, straight out of Hebrew mystical philosophy. I'm going to say that again. It's a concept straight out of Hebrew mystical philosophy. That's Kabbalah or Zohar or any of that stuff. In infinity fits the Christian metaphysical concept of the Father, while the infinite self-consciousness resident in that energy, providing the motive force of will to bring a portion of that energy into motion to create reality, corresponds with the Son. This is so because in order to attain self-consciousness, the consciousness of the Absolute must project a hologram of itself and then perceive it. That hologram is a mirror image of the Absolute in infinity. Still exists outside time and space, but is one step removed from the Absolute and is the actual agent of all creation, all reality. And the eternal thought or concept of self, which results from this self-consciousness, serves the... That page is missing. What? That page is missing. It's missing on my document. It goes from 34... to 37. It serves the something. Well, that was interesting, and I'm so glad that we have the Bible to read instead of that. Conclusion. There is a sound rational basis in terms of physical science parameters for considering Gateway to be plausible in terms of its essential objectives. Blah, blah, blah. The most promising approach suggested in the foregoing study involves the following steps. I'm going to just quickly get down to a couple of really interesting ones at the end. They're just telling you how to get into another state of consciousness. Jay, be intellectually prepared to react to possible encounters with intelligent, non-corporeal energy forms when time-space boundaries are exceeded. Did you get that? He's talking about demons. That's what he's talking about. Arrange to have groups of people in focus 12 state unite their altered consciousness to build holographic patterns around sensitive areas to repulse possible unwanted out-of-body presences. Okay. How crazy is this? Maybe that was too much information, but this is like a scientific explanation of occult powers, occult manifestations, a how-to guide on making contact through your consciousness to the spirit realm. This is just my hypothesis or speculation. If these false teachers, false prophets, the NAR, this whole movement is disguising doctrines of demons and selling them to Christians, is it not possible that they are also using these occult techniques and maybe teaching them, imparting them to other people? Maybe this is why we have so many people taking trips to heaven and seeing all these different things. Maybe some of these people are actually having an experience. Maybe some of them are lying and making it up. Maybe some of the people that are having these throne room experiences and visions of Jesus, maybe they actually are having a real vision. And maybe it's their own imagination of what their idea of Jesus is or their idea of heaven is. And maybe some of them are purposely doing this to deceive others. It's just another reason to get far away from these people, this movement, and all these doctrines of demons, and all their experiences, their mystical experiences. What do you think?
Run.
There's just one name that can keep you out of hell, and it's the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus. The name of Jesus.